إله إلا الله. محمد رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام.
ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا. صدق الله العظيم. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. دور شيخ الله Respected brothers, respected elders, mothers and sisters listening at home. Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala an was given the privilege to meet up with many great individuals during his term of Khilafat. And from amongst these great individuals, one very famous personality, a man who is famously known by the name Uwais bin Amir al-Qarni. Uwais bin Amir al-Qarni. Uwais was a very pious man. Scholars have mentioned that he is a tabi'i from the group of tabi'een. Now these are technical terms that the muhaddithin, the muakhirin, usually use to define the status of an individual. We have the time of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the era of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which is known as the best era, khayrul qurun, sabse behtareen zamana, the time of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam with the companions. The second best era is the era of tabi'een. Now these were individuals who did not see Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but had the honor to see the companions of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So they are known as the group of tabi'een. And then the third category is tabi' tabi'een, those that have seen the tabi'een. Tabi' tabi'een means those that have seen the tabi'een. Uwais bin Amir was from amongst the tabi'een. Not only was he a tabi'een, scholars have mentioned that he is the highest ranked tabi'een. So we have people like Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh, from amongst all the fuqaha. We have Imam Malik, Imam Shafi, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, Lais, and many other great fuqaha that we have had. None of them were tabi'een except for Imam Azam Abu Hanifa. Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi was a tabi'een. It is written in his seerah that he met up with Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala an many times. And so Uwais bin Amir was titled as Sayyidu Tabi'een, the leader of all the tabi'een. Like we have Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an, who is the highest ranked sahabi. In fact, not only the highest ranked sahabi, but scholars have said after Anbiya alayhi musallatu wassalam, he is the highest ranked individual, even greater than some of the personalities that were famously known in the previous ummah, in the previous communities. So we have Uwais bin Amir al-Qarni. Now Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala an was already given enough information of this individual, and this information was given to him by Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Whenever a group, a delegation would come to Madinatul Munawwara, especially from Yemen, Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an would always inquire that, have you got a person by the name Uwais bin Amir? He would always inquire whenever a group came. Now during the Khilafat of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an, you had wufood, Muslim armies, reinforcements, going for jihad in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, usually they would make a stop in Madinatul Munawwarah, and they would meet up with the Khalifa, Hazrat Umar ibn al-Khattab. Hazrat Umar ibn al-Khattab would give them hidayat, as in would advise them and explain to them the etiquette, the adab of jihad fi sabilillah. He would explain to them the etiquette of spreading Islam. So this was something that was expected in Madinatul Munawwara. Many groups, many individuals, many people would come from outside the Arabian Peninsula to join the Muslim army wherever jihad was going on. Subhanallah, on one occasion you had a group of people that came from Yemen. And when this news was given to Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala, again he came out and he met up with some of the people, the Yemeni people, and said to them, Afikum Uwais bin Amir, that is there a man in the midst of you by the name Uwais bin Amir? And some of the Yemeni said, Amirul Mu'mineen, yes, we have got a person whose name is Uwais bin Amir. Hazrat Umar said, take me to this individual. Now Hazrat Uwais was a very simple man, a quiet person. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an was taken to this man by the name Uwais bin Amir. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an's habit was always to greet a person and he would look at his face directly. Subhanallah. And this is the karamat of Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an. He was given the knowledge of reading the face, what is known as ilmul wujuh. Some people are gifted, and this was the karamat of Hazrat Umar. He would actually look at you and he would know exactly how deep you are in taqwa. Mazlok zahana, aage kuch aur, biche kuch aur hote. Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab was an incredible man, and that is why when we look at his khilafat period, the selection that he made in governors was top class, elite companions that he chose. Elite companions. And this was because of the knowledge. Nothing would just bypass Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Everything for him was important. So he stopped and he looked at the face of Hazrat Uwais radiallahu ta'ala. Hazrat Uwais looked back at Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala. It is mentioned that once Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala was with a group of people in a room. Many companions were there. And all of a sudden Hazrat Umar said to them, tamannau, tamannau, tamannau. Waitum tamanna karo. Wish for something, wish for something, wish for something. So some of the companions said, Amir al-Mu'mineen, what do you want us to wish? Whatever you want to wish. Imagine, if Allah was to fulfill all your wishes, what would your wish be? Tamannau, tamanna karo, right? What is your wish? And so some of the companions looked at each other and they said, Sha Amirul Mu'mineen, we would wish that this entire room would be filled up with gold and silver. Filled up with gold and silver. But look how pure Sahaba-i Kiram ajma'in were. Not for us. Gold and silver, not for us. It wasn't for us. They were not after wealth. Wealth would be after them. Wealth would come to them. And they said, this entire room would be filled with dirham and dinar, and Allah would give us the opportunity to give every dinar and dirham in the path of Allah. Subhanallah. So this is our wish. Tamannau, this is our tamanna, to give everything in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala and said, khair. And then some of them said, Amirul Mu'mineen, what is your wish? What is your wish? Subhanallah. Let me relate to you the wish of Hazrat Umar ibn al-Khattab. What an incredible man he was. He said to the group of companions, now behind every kalam, the words that come out from the mouth of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala and they are important lessons for us. There is hikmah in everything what he said. He said, my wish would be that this entire room would be filled with the likes of Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah and Mu'adh ibn al-Jabal. my tamanna, my wish would be that this room would be filled with the likes of people like Mu'az ibn al-Jabal and Hazrat Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. These were great, great commanders, Amir in the battlefield. Great Amir. And I would send each one of them in the path of Allah, jihad fi sabilillah. This is my tamanna. And if you remember, during the Khilafat of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala, and this is the allocation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Hazrat Khalid bin Walid covered the entire military expedition during the Khilafat of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. Subhanallah, this is the taqseem of Allah. That he was there shoulder to shoulder with Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. But when Khilafat was given to Hazrat Umar Farooq, Hazrat Umar Farooq chose Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu ta'ala over Khalid bin Walid radiyallahu ta'ala. Again, an excellent commander, an excellent warrior, an excellent soldier, Hazrat Mu'az ibn al-Jabal and people like Hazrat Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. And I would send each one of them jihad fi sabilillah. This is my tamanna. Muhaddithin have mentioned that there are lessons to be learned in the words of Hazrat Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala. Hazrat Umar ibn al-Khattab was actually educating the companion that your financial resources are not as important as your human resources. Your human resources are much more important than your financial capacity. This is what he was explaining to the companion. That though you wish for dirham and dinar to be filled up in this room, but in reality dirham and dinar have no power like manpower, human resources. So what he was saying, that we are looking for dynamic individuals. What did Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam leave behind? A financial network? Did he leave behind a bank? A lot of money? Did he leave behind skyscrapers, Madinatul Munawwara? Did they have a lot of high, lofty buildings? Kuch bhi nahi. Simple hut in Madinatul Munawwara. Masjid al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so simple, mud walls. And when it would rain, the water would even drip through the roof of Masjid al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But what he left behind, the legacy of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is the Quran, the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ingrained in the hearts of the companions. The kalam of Allah ingrained in the hearts of the companions. Sahaba-i kiram ajma'een were so dynamic and giants of their time that even the Persians and the Romans would crave to see someone who is a Sahabi. Never mind Muslims. But it was a trend also with the non-Muslims. Oh, that person is a Sahabi. So he was some kind of a superhuman being. That he is a Sahabi. He is a Sahabi. And people would travel miles and miles and miles just to come to Madinatul Munawwara and make salam to Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. These people were so great. Allah's Nabi has said, Ashabi kan nujum, my companions are like stars. Bi ayyihu muqtadaytum ihtadaytum. Anyone who you follow, Allah will guide you. Any one of them, if you were to just pick them randomly and just to throw them in any part of the world, that one goes there, one goes there, one goes there, wallahi lazim, a Sahabi is so powerful that one Sahabi is enough to take on that entire region. That entire region would become Muslim. Why? Allahu Akbar. It was not the outside that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam worked on. It was the inside. Once the inside is made, it has an effect on the outside also. So these were great individuals. Their nufus, their ruh, subhanallah, their level of taqwa was made. These were the students of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So wherever they went, subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would open the doors of hidayat. Now if you look at the spread of Islam during the time of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is very isolated. Everything really opened up during the Khilafat of Hazrat Abu Bakr, Hazrat Umar Farooq, Hazrat Uthman, Hazrat Ali, and the Khulafa and these great pious people, our predecessors, the Tabi'een and Tabi'een, why they were dynamic people. Their hearts were made. So this was the lesson given by Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, that once your inside is made, insha'Allah, dinar and dirham will come. Dinar and dirham will come. Look at Spain, my respected brothers. 800 years of Muslim rule. Even today, Spain has a good revenue coming in by the masjid made by the Muslims. The biggest extension in the Islamic world was the Qurtuba Masjid. Only now Masjid Nabawi and Haramain Sharif beats the Qurtuba Masjid. Even today you have hundreds of visitors coming to the Qurtuba Masjid, where Allama Qurtubi Rahmatullah Alayh would sit and write his tafsir, Ahkamul Quran. But what happened today? It's all taken away. We were very forward progressing in technology. There was progression in every department. Externally everything was good. Internally we were corrupted. The heart was not made. There was something wrong inside. Futur tha. And that is why we see that everything was taken away from us. Sahaba-i kiram ajmain, what would they wear? A lungi. A lungi. Lungi to dekhiye na. A simple lungi. Just a loin cloth, something that would cover the bottom section. And that is it. But wherever they went, Allahu Akbar. That izzat, the taqwa. When they would march forward, it was the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that would guide them. So what we need to do today also, my brothers in Islam, is to be very sincere, to be clean. What we show outside should also manifest inside. So if you show taqwa from the outside, you must really be a muttaqi person from inside. You can't be muttaqi for the people of Masjid Umar, and when you go home, you're a terrorist to the wife. You're a terrorist to the wife. And the wife would taunt you, I know you. The whole world says you are something. The only reality is that I know who you are. So we can't do that. We have to be what we are. And we should work on that. And this was the khubi, the greatness of Sahaba-i Kiram Ajma'in. So going back to Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala, and he stopped. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala, and Allahu Akbar, we can't talk about this great man. I recall one incident that I read, and this is a true incident, narrated by Hazrat Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala. Hazrat Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala says that once Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala went to the barber. Now to be the barber for Hazrat Umar is a mission, isn't it? That man was very careful. Umar ki dari mubarak ke baal, sar ke baal, ki tari. This was this natural ru'ab, this power, this natural awe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given him. This is the making of Hazrat Umar. Now all of a sudden Hazrat Umar coughed. Hazrat Ibn Abbas says when he coughed, what happened to the barber? This barber actually urinated. He actually urinated. And these waqi'at are haqa'iq. This is a true fact. And Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala felt so bad and guilty. He said, I'm very sorry, I did not mean to scare you in any way. And he said, no, Amirul Mu'minin. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala paid him in compensation 40 dinar. One dinar is a gold coin. One dinar is a gold coin. He paid how much? 40 dinar. This is Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala. Maki ye koi mazaki baat nahi. Telling you the truth. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala was a very serious man. He was famously known. People would come. People recognized him. Subhanallah al-Azim. So he came and he looked at Hazrat Uwais. And again, just to confirm everything, Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala started questioning him. Said to him, you are Uwais bin Amir al-Karni? And Hazrat Uwais said, Naam, the Amir al-Mu'mineen is it. He said, right. You were suffering from leprosy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you shifa. He said, yes. I was suffering from leprosy, Allah gave me shifa. Hazrat Umar said, except for one spot, which is equivalent to the size of a coin on the palms of your hands. And he said, yes. And he showed that skin pigmentation to Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala said to him, your mother has passed away, but you are very passionate to serve her, to look after her. And he said, yes. And then Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala said to Hazrat Uwais, I want you to make dua for me. I want you to make dua for me. Now we'll stop for a brief few minutes. Here, a Sahabi, not only a Sahabi, a Khalifa of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hazrat Umar, who is much higher in rank and in position than a Tabi'i, who is Uwais bin Amir al-Qarni, a Sahabi Hazrat Umar is asking a Tabi'i, Uwais bin Amir al-Qarni, to make dua for who? Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Lessons to take in. Muhaddithin have mentioned that first of all, this was a direct command from Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah's Nabi had said to Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, Ya'tikum Uwais bin Amir bi amradil Yaman, that when you become a Khalifa, a time will come that a group of Yemeni people will come, and in that group will be one man whose name will be Uwais bin Amir. When he comes, Umar, I want you to give my salam to him and tell him to make dua for you. Allahu Akbar. He was a wali of Allah. And that is why scholars have given him this crown, this title, that he is Sayyidul Tabi'in. For someone to receive the salam of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as an amanat from Hazrat Umar Farooq, and then for Hazrat Umar Farooq to ask Uwais bin Amir to make dua for me. Allahu Akbar. This is a man of great repute and honor. Scholars have mentioned there is a lesson here. No one should feel that he is indispensable. No one should feel that the person in front of me is unworthy. Even if he is lower in rank than you, it is the duty of a Muslim to greet him, to make salam to him, and even to ask him to make dua for him. In fact, even if a child who is nabalig, if he is in front of you, you can even ask him to make dua for me. Maybe Allah will listen to his dua. So as Muslims, we are not to judge anyone. Even if he is a great Khalifa like Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, this is the lesson of humility. Ye aajizi ka sabak sikhaya gaya hai. To be humble at all times. Though Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an was of a higher rank, undoubtedly. There is no question about that. But yet, he did not have arrogance or pride to ask Uwais bin Amir al-Qarni to make dua for him. And we find such events that there are many in the books of a hadith. Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at times would praise Anbiya alayhim salam that came before him so highly that it would be even difficult for an individual to make distinction between the Prophet and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah's Nabi has praised Ibrahim alayhi salam, Musa alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, Yunus alayhi salam so highly that who is of a higher rank, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or these Prophets? Now alhamdulillah, being the followers of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are well informed that Rasulullah is Sayyidul Awwaleen wal Akhireen. But this was humility, this is tawazu, ajizi. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very humble. He praised Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam. He praised Yunus alayhi salam. In one hadith he said, don't say that I am better than Yunus alayhi salatu wa salam. Many a hadith. But the truth is, Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the best creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one is greater than Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Again, the Muhaddithin have even mentioned Allah blessed him, Uwais bin Amir, with this honor. Why? He was the contemporary of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was alive during the time of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but because the mother was completely disabled, it was Uwais only who was serving the mother, and it is his service for looking after the mother that deprived him from achieving this very high rank of being a Sahabi. Now Allah's Nabi knew of his khulus, that he wanted to come from Yemen to Madinatul Munawwara many times to meet Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he was aashiq-e Rasul. Ye aaj kal ke logon ki tarah aashiq-e Rasul nahi. We have people who say, oh, these guys, tablighis, barelvis, tablighis, ye to wahabi, these people don't love Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani. They don't believe in awliyaullah. They make an objection. Deobandi, tablighi, ye sab bure log hai. Why? They don't love Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How do you know? How do you know that the Arabs don't love Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Are you in this position to accuse someone that in his heart there is no love for Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Wala hawla wala quwwata illa billah. These are the juhala of the time. He was the wali of Allah, the aashiq of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But yet he knew that the Quran instructs me to look after my mother. The Sunnah instructs me to look after my mother. With ikhlas he stayed in Yemen looking after the mother. Although he was deprived from this honor of being a Sahabi, but Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave his personal salam to him, and he was titled as being Sayyidu Tabi'een. SubhanAllah. Ulama have mentioned, by doing khidmat of your mother and father, Allah opens the doors of rizq. Allah opens the doors of sustenance, livelihood. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you honor and izzah when you look after your mother. Like how Allah gave honor and izzah to Uwais radiallahu rahmatullah alayhi, Uwais bin Amir al-Karni. Allah give us the tawfiq that we also make qadr of our parents. Grandparents who have passed away, we must do isal sawab all the time, pray Quran, pray nawafil, and give them the sawab. Furthermore, Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala said to Hazrat Uwais, you are going towards Kufa, let me write a letter to the governor of Kufa, so that the governor of Kufa will look after you. Hamar aap ho to? A letter written by Hazrat Umar that the governor of Kufa must look after who? Hazrat Uwais bin Amir. These were awliyaullah who would run away from pain. He said to Amirul Mu'mineen, I want to live in discreet, in obscurity, a simple man that I am. I want no fame. Please don't write a letter to the governor. Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an respected his opinion and did not write a letter for him. It is said he stayed in Kufa for 1 year anonymously. No one knew of it, of his wilayat. Until one day in Madinatul Munawwara, again someone from the tribe of Qarn, a Yemeni, came to meet Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an. Hazrat Umar was sitting in the masjid and said to him that you are from the tribe of Qarn, Yemeni, and he said yes. Hazrat Umar said to him, tell me, what is the condition of Uwais bin Amir al-Qarni? So he said, Amirul Mu'mineen, you know him? He said, yes, I know him. Tell me, how is he? He says, oh, he's a man of mujahada. Poverty has stricken on him. There is no furniture in his house. A simple man who does not eat much. He has got nothing of this dunya. So Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala said to this man, when you go to him, ask him to make dua for you. When you go to him, ask him to make dua for you. Now this man knew that Uwais must be a special man. If Hazrat Umar is asking me to ask him to make dua for me, this man came back to Kufa and he greeted Uwais bin Amir al-Karni and said to him, Sheikh, I want you to make dua for me. So that Uwais turned at him and said, you want me to make dua? Why don't you make dua yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He says, no, I want you to make dua. Where she's saying, no, no, I want you to do dua for yourself. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why should I make dua for you? He said, no, you have to make dua. Now Hazrat Uwais said to him, by chance, have you met Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala? And he said, yes, I have just come back from Medina and have met up with Hazrat Umar. Now he knew that news would spread very, very fast. Rumor spread very, very quickly. Allahu Akbar Kabira. Now these were people who would run away from shame. Immediately this man made dua for this person, and he left Kufa and he vanished. No one knew of his whereabouts, where he was. The Mu'arikhin have mentioned, historians, that the information we have is that for the rest of his life, Hazrat Uwais bin Amir al-Qarni became a mujahid and he fought jihad fi sabilillah for the rest of his life. So these were great, great individuals, awliyaullah, who met up with Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. اللهم صل على سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وسلم تسليما. اللهم تقبل منا وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. اللهم اس مجلس کو قبول فرما. اللهم اس مجلس کو قبول فرما. اللہ اس مجلس میں جو پریشان حال ہے، مستورات جو پریشان حال ہے، ہر ایک کی پریشانی کو دور فرما. جو بیمار ہے اللہ ان کو شفا دے. اللہ ہمیں توفیق دے صاحب قرآن بن جائے. نبی کریم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کی محبت، اولیاء اللہ کی محبت، صحابہ کرام اجمعین کی محبت ہمیشہ دل میں رہے. اللہ ہمارا خاتمہ بالخیر ہو. اللہ ہمارا خاتمہ بالخیر ہو. اللہ موت کے وقت آپ کی رحمت ہو، مدد ہو، سکرات کے وقت سہولت ہو. اللہ ایمان کی حالت سے دنیا سے ہم رخصت ہو جائے. رب اغفر وارحم وانت خير الراحمين. رب اغفر وارحم وانت خير الراحمين. سمعنا واطعنا.